happened if Matt were here today, how the course of events would have changed. He was saying earlier, if he would have had 20 extra minutes, because clearly he wouldn't be the last one ready. Just nice to take some time to sort of pull Matthew's spirit up and be able to take that with us for the rest of the day. So first going to have Zach.
Well, thanks everyone for putting this together, for Lisa and Norma Jude for putting this together, and thanks everyone for coming. So it's interesting that we're at reunions because often at reunions I think back to 15 years ago after we graduated from Princeton, when Matt and Nate and I and a few other friends from elementary school, we went on a cross-country road trip after college, and the whole entire month Matt never took off his plastic reunion bracelet. And I think this sums up Matt's unique brand of charm and sentimentality that we all know, that he was devoted to what he loved, and he was defiant and never wanted to let things go. Matt and I have known each other since first grade, through Hebrew school and our baseball team, which won the league championship, and we all wrote about it for our college essays. And we created an everlasting bond with Nick Aller, who was our coach. And this is no doubt what brought us to Princeton. In college, I really loved hanging out with Matt, and I'll get to know all of his Wilson and Charter friends, because Matt was friends with so many different people, so many different groups of people, because his superpower was that he could talk to anyone. He always riled people up with little insults, and he sort of reveled in the jabs that came back. And you know, any of the times that I had a girlfriend, like instantly, she like was in love with Matt. They instantly clicked. And one summer, actually, we went on a CJL trip to Israel together, and Matt would continually poke fun of everyone on the trip, especially like the hippie tendencies of the kids from UC Santa Cruz that were on our trip. And all of the women on the trip loved Matt. And typical of Matt was that he spent years fueling a non-existent feud between me and our classmate, Mike Weiner. This is sort of an excerpt of an email that I found. He wrote to me and Mike and Lisa from Spain. He said, "Zach, Mikey W's arch nemesis and triangle thespian. Are you going to be in Spain anytime soon? If so, email me." And then he said, "Mikey W, Zach's and villain acquaintance and bridge building rock climber extraordinaire. Same goes for you, will you be in Spain? Let me know." And then he said, Lisa, and then he said, "Nothing clever is coming to mind." It was ironic that Matt in the Woodrow Wilson School studied how to stop conflict among people, and yet what Matt knew so instinctively was that conflict was also what brought people together. I also found some other emails that Matt sent, and looking back to my college emails, here's one from South Africa to a group of us. He said, "Before I begin, I would like to point out that the computers here are very bad, very, very bad. Imagine me eating, but about 10 times slower with severe constipation problems." And he had tables of contents in the email. He said, one of the table of contents items was roommate with malaria. Does it get any better than this? And he ended the email with, "Love you guys, and I'll get back to you individually later. Hope you all read this, and if you didn't, fuck you, because with the amount of times your computer froze, I've been here typing for 86 minutes. And here's one asking us to come to a stand-up comedy show. He said, "For those of you who missed last year's event, you didn't miss much. Nate pretty much kicked my ass, but this year things will be different, I hope. For one thing, the cash prize is substantially higher, $150, and a person could buy a lot of clothes at Marshall's for $150. Matt bought all his clothes at Marshall's. And yes, after graduation, we embarked on this cross-country road trip in Norman Judy's SUV. God bless Norman Judy for letting us do this, especially since we got 3 speeding tickets and a flat tire in the middle of the desert. And during this road trip, Matt wanted to go to exactly 3 places: the Grand Canyon, Cedar Point Amusement Park in Sandusky, Ohio, and a store in Alabama where you can buy lost items from people's airplane luggage. And the first 2 were fine, but we were not driving 3 hours out of our way to go to this store. And Matt was adamant that we'd missed out on $100 laptops that we could have bought. In every city, Matt wanted to go to McDonald's. And this was actually, I just remembered, a few weeks after he'd smuggled Burger King into the baccalaureate speech in the chapel. And he was eating it during the speech. So, you know, during the trip, you'd have to trade off one interesting local restaurant and one McDonald's. And on this trip, we stayed with some of you. We stayed with Marco, we stayed with Georgia, and had an amazing time in San Francisco. And I remember from the notes that I took from our trip, so we went on one of those like rides where you sit on a magic carpet and there's a green screen behind it, and then, you know, they create a video of you like flying on a magic carpet through the city. And I wrote down that Matt insisted on buying the mouse pad with a photo of us on it on the magic carpet, which you would never usually buy, but Matt really wanted to. And the point is that Matt had simple tastes, but he didn't care what we actually did. He just wanted to hang out and find ways to mark the occasion and cement the memory in our minds. And since that trip, you know, every time I go to Prince reunions and I cut off my reunion bracelet, I wonder how long Matt would want to keep it on, because he wouldn't want to let it go. So we miss you, Matt, and we wish you could be here this weekend.
Gotten through this yet in rehearsal without kind of losing it, so please do bear with me. It was kind of interesting. It was a tricky kind of memory to write, because I wanted to say something that would really honor Matt, and so to have a speech that honors him, I knew it would have to be funny, but I know it can't be nearly funny enough to do justice to Matt. And I know we'd need a 3-hour philosophical digression into I think we would all miss the P-rate if I did that. And I knew that to honor Matt, I'd have to write it at the absolute last minute in little scraps of paper, and so that was something I could actually achieve. So thanks, Matt, for that general life tip. So we talk about so many like amazing stories of Matt, and there are so many about them. So I thought back, like, what stories really capture Matt the most to me? I realized it wasn't really any of the like amazing punchlines or any of the set pieces or these like ridiculous antics that he got up to, but whenever I think about Matt, I just think about having conversations with him. That he was someone who we spent, I think all of you spent hundreds, probably thousands of hours in conversations in the most filthy dorm rooms, in the most, in charter for hours and hours, in this infamous Alero, taking the most unhurried drives when you actually had somewhere to get down 95. And so I think that's what I like to talk about the most, is conversations with Matt. And the very first time that I met Matt, actually, we both, for various roommate reasons, weren't able to spend the night in our own rooms, and ended up in the basement study room of 1937, which is completely stifling, windowless room, and way too late for anyone to be up. And we immediately after meeting had a 2-hour conversation about The Truman Show, some movie that we'd both seen. And even talking about the most mundane thing with Matt immediately becomes a discussion about existentialism and choices and what it's like to live and how you should live and how you should make choices. And it was really clear from that first moment that Matt was someone who was never gonna choose the conventional route, was never gonna choose to stay in the pretty fantasy. And we had, that was the first conversation, and it was the first of thousands of conversations that would go on from there. I remember so many years of him holding court in charter, getting there at 5:30 sharp, to be one of the first people there, one of the few things he was on time for, so we could sit at a table and hold court for hours and hours. Like, he was playing foosball where the winner gets to keep the table. And he always kept the table as a stream of people came in, joined him for conversation, and wandered off as he remained the champion of every conversation there. And he had this amazing gravitational ability to bring together people from biggest athletes to the nerdiest engineers. And I wondered for a long time how he's able to do that, and what sort of magic he had that brought all these people together. And I think what it came down to me for me is that he is someone who had deeply felt principles about even the most mundane things in the entire world that he would hold staunchly to, and everything became a deeply felt philosophical point that he also felt great joy from. So his desire to get a deal was not convenient. It was not something that he just liked. It was an absolute deep philosophical principle that you have to get the greatest deal you can. And something that brought him absolute joy when he found a nicely boxed shirt in the slightly irregular area of Marshalls. So he had a little celebration about it to save a few dimes on that. It was something that he could find joy in every time. His deeply held belief that anything worth doing is worth doing at the absolute last second. and often brightly, almost always brightly, is something that I think we'll always take with us. And it so much of his genius came from that impulse. I think, you know, he taught many conventional Hebrew school classes, but probably his ultimate move was when he completely forgot about a Hebrew school class he'd teach and decided just to import his Lebanese roommate to prove that Jews and Arabs can get along. If he had planned in advance, surely we would not have gotten that lesson from him. But, you know, his most deeply held and most often expressed principle was that he would do absolutely anything for a friend. I think, you know, deep in his autonomic system, in the base of his brain, he had some ability to, you know, breathe and sleep and drive friends to the airport. That it was just such a reflex that as soon as airport gets up, and it's never an obligation for him, it's another dance because we get to spend more time together, and maybe he'll drive there 15 miles an hour, even no matter how late you are. But that was something that he just believed in so deeply, that you absolutely have to do something for a friend, and it's not really a question or argument. And I think that ultimately is, I think, why he was able to bring so many people together. Like, why would you not want to stay up? What possible better use of your time that you have than staying up all night with someone who turns the most mundane parts of life into philosophy and joy? And how could you not want to have another 100 hours of conversation or another 1,000 hours of conversation with him right now? And I know I do, I think we all do. So we miss you, Matt, and thank you, Matt, for all the years and hours and conversations you have with all of us. It'll be with us forever, and we appreciate it.
So as I was envisioning standing before this wonderful community today, I kept having to remind myself, I actually did this earlier, to remind myself that Matthew wouldn't be here, but with these speeches and hanging out with all of you, I feel like he's here, right? And his spirit's strong in this room and within the dear faces of those friends who knew him and loved him and continue to love him, and who knew him when he was full of life and teeming with humor and ready to debate at any moment and about any topic, no matter how banal. Like many of you, I knew Matthew before I knew Matthew because of these signs. Thank you so much, Judy. Thank you for bringing these. I think I, along with all of you, and my father, I don't know how many times my father has told this story about this, because I mean, it is just so classic Matt, that gene, right, where he made fun of himself and all of us and all of our parents, right, all of our family members. I mean, it's too good, and he was such a keen observer of people and of the world, and with this seven-word slogan, he was able to poke fun at everyone in the most joyous Matt ways. In addition to making us laugh, as Zach and John spoke so beautifully about, Matt was always there for his friends, and he would drive people to and from the airport in his amazingly messy car. I don't know what happened with the SUV, but had to move all the cigarette packs and all the other things. I still took the ride to the airport, but had to move all of that. And would take long walks at night to pick up food from the WA for his roommates, and he would stay awake into the wee hours of the night to discuss, you know, anything and everything with whomever was awake. And I can't believe how many more hours of awake time I ended up having because Matt was in my life. I definitely would have been asleep earlier. But like John said, I mean, it was so special to have those times with Matt. And he enjoyed meeting up for dinner with people. By then he was awake. I think dinner for me was usually breakfast or lunch for him. and discussing or debating all of these philosophical questions. His intelligence was